in the class, certain students, then they will feel, okay, that's worth it, that class is worth to come. Yeah? Some yani good students, inshallah, like all of you, inshallah. Yeah? So, subhanAllah, yani today I was reading a story of one of the scholars in Morocco, rahimahullah. And he had a student, and he used to be, like I'm not talking now, yani nearly 100 years ago or something like that, around 50 or 60, between 60 and 100 years ago. So this scholar, he was very humble. And he was kind of, he was very easy with his students, to the extent they took advantage of him. So he used to come to the masjid, and his masjid was in front of his house. He would come, if he see the students, he will go, he will teach. If he didn't see them, he would stay at home. And after the salah. So they had a time, for example, after you pray asr, he will go home, and then after that, he should be there. So and one day, his two students, they come. Or some of his students, they come. None of them came. So he came to the halaqa. He looked, no one was there. So then he went home. What happened? The students, they said, let's knock on the sheikh's door. They were very late. So they knocked on his door. Yeah? And then he said to them, wait a minute, just stay here a minute. And for people who knows the houses in Morocco, some houses they have, for example, first floor, yeah? And then he said, then while we are waiting outside the door, then we saw the sheikh came from the window upstairs and he had a bucket of water. Then he poured the bucket on us. So the sheikh, he said, this is, he deserves it for being late for the class. SubhanAllah, they used to be give tarbiyah. And the tarbiyah for the students are more important than the teaching itself. Imam al-Awza'i, rahmullah, great scholar of the past. Imam, great imam. And he had a nasty dog in front of his house. He had a big dog, massive dog, and he used to put the dog in front by the entrance of his house. And as you know, that the muhaddithin, or the people of hadith, who are involved in hadith, you know the people who are what we call them, I don't know what's the right word in English, but those ones who are you don't like to sit with them. They are very, I don't know what's the right word actually. I don't know what's the, people who are, you don't like to sit with them because they are, they're very annoying, you could say. Very annoying people. And the students of hadith used to be annoying because they always come, even when you kicked. They said, the students of hadith, you kick them from the door, they will come from the window. They don't care. They will just keep coming. Yeah? Because they value the hadith. It doesn't matter if the sheikh humiliate them, if the sheikh humiliate us, if the sheikh did whatever he did to us, we'll come to the sheikh because we need to learn. That's our path to Jannah. That's how they used to think about attending the classes. So this great Imam al-Awza'i, he had a big dog in front of his house. And if you are able to go through that dog, then you are a good student of knowledge. So anyone, no one will come except his, the dog will rip their clothes or will do something to them. At least it's enough to be terrifying the students. So and no one will have the courage to come in except someone who doesn't care as long as he attends the class. And when the dog died, yeah, then the students they start coming normally, yeah. So Imam al-Awza'i one day he was sad. And when the dog died, he was sad. He said, why are you sad for a dog? He said, no. He said, the one who used to enjoy the good and forbid the evil just died now. This is the dog was enjoying the good and forbidding the evil. Because now everyone is coming now. People who worthy the hadith, who are worthy to be taught the hadith, and people who's not worthy, everyone will be coming. And I remember something which is a personal story. I remember my sheikh, when I started living with him, I remember I came, we had a meeting after Dhuhr. So I came to his house and he said to me, wait. He kept me from Dhuhr to Asr in front of his house. In the sun, in Jordan. And I remember that. And just before Asr, and I was there. I said, I was shy to him because he knows I'm outside. We just came in, we prayed Dhuhr together and he went inside. And then he came up and he said, I know that you're going to stay. So he was kind of testing, And that's a way of tarbiyah sometimes. You don't all the time just be, you know, easy with the students, and this is in the future for you, inshallah ta'ala. You teach others, even when you teach the children as well. You know, sometimes be firm with them, inshallah. Okay, to continue, where we reach? We finished about the hadith, which is about what are the things that the person should do in the sujood. As well, between the two sajda, we said between the two sajda, we told you how to sit. We said there's iqa, which means to sit on your heels, or sometimes to sit on your left foot and to raise the right foot, and this is the two ways in sitting between the two sajda. As the two hadith narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha and narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. As well, and do not, one of the things as well, and another mistake, come with me, brother. Come home. Can you come? You can come. So now, suppose you did the two sajda here in the front of us, yeah? Do the first sajda and do the yours. And if you are sitting in the next sajda, sit down. Yeah? Sit down. Yeah? What you said, how you sit between the two sajda? Like this. Do the second sajda. Do the second sajda. How you stand up after the second sajda? Now you want to stand up. What do you do? Yeah. That he what he did, it doesn't invalidate the salah. But he forget a sunnah. What's the sunnah? It's to sit after the sajda, then to stand up. You don't do it? Yeah? So you go sajda. Yeah? And then sit. As you sit between the two sajda, yeah? And then you stand up. How you stand up? You could stand up like this. There is a little hadith, something called ajil, meaning people making dough. Have you seen some people making dough? They do their fist. So when you stand up, try to stand up with a fist. So when you stand up, rely on your fist, stand up. That's another sunnah, which is as well, forbidden sunnah. Show us. Zakallah. Yeah? So you sit after the second sajda. Sit after the second sajda. And then, yeah, by the fist, and then you stand up. So these are ways, the sunnah, these things that you get reward from Allah Azza wa Jalla by implementing the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as well, when you stand up, as well to rely on the ground, meaning rely with your hand on the ground, and as we said to you, these are then forgetting sunnah. Forgetting sunnah is to rely on your fist when you're standing. فقلت لأبي قلابة وكيف كان الصلاة؟ قال مثل صلاة شيخنا هذا يعني عمرو بن سلمة قال أبي كذا في شكل تم تكبير إذا رفع رأسه من السجدة الثانية جلس واعتمد على الأرض ثم قال meaning he relied on the ground as he stand. أن يكون جلوسه في التشهدين على ما جاء فيه الأحاديث. And as well the two تشهد should be according to the two hadith mentioned in these two hadith. The first hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he sat between the two rak'ah, or after the two rak'ah, then he will sit on the right foot. Yeah, sorry, on the left foot. And he will raise the right foot. And when he sit in the last one, قدم رجله اليسرى ونصب الأخرى وقعد على مقعدته. Now what we call it, this is the second way. Can someone show us, please? Yeah, same one. Now,
sitting after the second sajda, how do you sit between the after the second sajda? How do you sit? There's one way after that, sorry after that, two sajda, two rak'ah. How do you sit? Sit down. You finish the two rak'ah, you do the tashahhud, in the tashahhud you sit like that, yeah, but in the last one, what you do, in the last one what you do, that's way, there is another way, is put your left foot underneath, yeah. And sit on your bottom. Yeah, no. Not on the floor, not on the floor, don't sit on the floor. Sit on the floor. Can you do that? You know what I mean? Okay. I will show you. So in sitting between the two sajda, we sit, or between the two rak'ah, or the after the second rak'ah, we sit like that in this part. Yeah? But in the last one, it's like this. This is the last one. Yeah, you sit, you raise the right foot up like that, and you put your left foot underneath your shin, your right shin, and you sit like this. This is in the last tashahhud. This is how you do in the last tashahhud. So this is the sunnah of the Prophet. This is how you do it in the last tashahhud. This is during the last shahur, especially which one? If you pray three rak'ah or four rak'ah. Yeah? If you pray three rak'ah or four rak'ah, this is how you say it. And there is no difference between men and women in that. So after the second rak'ah, you say, as I told you, you say to your left foot. Yeah? But in the, if you pray three rak'ah or four rak'ah, then you do what? You sit, yeah, on your bottom, and you raise your right foot, and you put your left foot underneath your right shin. This is how you do when you say three or more. Okay. To continue. وعن ابن عمر رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان ذي الدهر وضع كفه اليمنى على فخذه اليمنى. So he will put his right hand on his thigh. وقبض أصابعه كله وأشار بأصبعه التي الإبهام التي تلي الإبهام وضع كفه اليسرى على فخذه اليسرى. Meaning in the salah, so you put your left and right, all of them, you put them on your thighs. Yeah. You don't need to grab your knees, yeah, just on your thighs. And in the tashahud, you grab with your thumb these three fingers and you raise the indexed finger and you raise it. And we say to you, so you start in the beginning of the tashahud like that, say tahiyatul salat al-baqi until you say inshallah to raise it properly. And then after that, when you start the dua from the salah al-Ibrahimi, the durood sharif, all the way to the end of the dua, moving the finger. وعن نافع كان عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنه إذا جلس الصلاة وضع يدي على ركبته وأشار بإصبعه وأتبعها بصره ثم قال الرسول لهي أشد على الشيطان من الحديد. Yeah, and as well raise the finger, and as well by moving the finger while, or raising the finger while this, and here, and he was looking into, so that's why in the tashahud you could look into the place of your sujood, or to look into your index tujar, which means when you are doing like this, you just look at your index or the place of your sujood. This is in the shahud. And he said, it is more severe on the shaitan than to be hit by the iron, by an iron hammer. Now, listen to this, yeah? And that's something as well, we need to share this story, inshallah, with you. You know, sometimes some people, when they wanted to try to interpret the Quran and Sunnah according to their intellect, they will use the analogy that they are aware of. So for example, hold on a second, the shaitan, you know, goes everywhere. He goes in the wall, he comes out, and to be hammered with iron and hammer, it doesn't harm him. Yeah? How is that? So one day, there is a man in one big company in Jordan. And generally, the good thing in the Arab countries and generally Muslim countries, that the one who did the salah, it doesn't matter, could be the cleaner, who's the imam, leading the salah, and behind him the general manager of the company. Yeah, that's no, because they generally will be the one who's more religious, the one who's more having Quran. That generally, alhamdulillah, in many places, alhamdulillah, in the Muslim country. So this man was in one of these workers working in a company, and he is a student of knowledge. And sometimes after every salah, we'll bring a hadith. He will was teaching the, you know, the people who are working in the company about the salah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he came to this hadith, and he was teaching this hadith to the people. So one behind him, his manager, one of the general manager, or not general manager, one of the manager, one of his senior ones. Yeah. So he said to him, he said, this senior manager, when he left, he said, what's this, you know, this, the one such and such, I mean, yes, he is, they call him Tawwi'a or whatever, I mean, someone who's a religious person. But what do you mean by he's hit by iron? What's this? How you grab the shaitan to hit with iron? With iron hammer? It doesn't, I couldn't comprehend it with our intellect. So that person who was this manager or that senior person was talking to came to this student of knowledge, and he told him, you know, this guy, he was saying such and such. How we could respond to that? And then
he did something bad, but at the same time it led to something good. So he said to him, okay, then go and tell him such and such in giving you that. By the way, in the Middle East, the middle finger is different, they use it in a different way. So he said, give him this middle finger to him. He said, what do you say? He said, just go and do that to him. So they went, and he went to the senior, and he was saying to him, he said, I did this to you. So he was jumping up and down, I'm going to fire him, he's going to stay in the company, that's it, he's done all the, how does he break? And he said these things, he should be, you know, he should be ashamed of himself. You know, he has beard, he has this, he has that. So he said, call him. So they brought him to the scene. He said, how come, how dare you say this about me? While he was in this, he said, calm down. You know, I wanted to explain to you, just calm down. Then after that senior guy came down, he said to him, listen, I only give you a finger. it's a finger. And it was worse on you than him being hammered with iron hammer yourself. You know, it made to you things. Yeah, it made to you. It was more a humiliation to you than to be hit by even a car accident. Yeah? And how do you, it is the same thing. Why don't you accept this? For the shaitan, the same thing. Yeah? We are humiliating the shaitan with this because it's a sign of tawheed. Yeah, so it is worse on shaitan than to be iron, than to be hit by an iron hammer. Yeah, so that alhamdulillah he wasn't kicked out from the company, which is good. Alhamdulillah, he thought about it. The manager, he said, yeah, you're saying right. What you're saying is correct. The point is of this story that sometimes, you know, in certain things we cannot comprehend. If you cannot comprehend with your own mind, limited mind, it doesn't mean it's wrong. Because there could be some explanation, which is you're not aware of that. طيب, we finish all these actions that you should do within the salah, and better for you to do in the salah. Now, after that, he said, here the remembrance after the salah, or the adhkar after the salah. And Thawban, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he used to finish the salah, Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam, tabarak ya dal jalal wal ikram. And as well, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when he finished his salah, he used to do istighfar, astaghfirullah, three times, and then he used to say, Allahumma innaka anta salam wa minka salam, tabarak ya dal jalal wal ikram. وعن أبي الزبير كان ابن الزبير يقول في دبر كل صلاة he said لا إله الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله لا إله إلا الله ولا نعبد إلا إياه له النعمة وله الفضل وله الثناء والحسن لا إله إلا الله مخلصا له الدين ولو كره الكافرون. And he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say this after every salah. And as well, وعن وراد بن المغيرة بن شعبة قال that he wrote to المغيرة بن شعبة إلى معاوية. He wrote that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he finished his salah, to say, لا إله الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا ينفع ذا الجد منك الجد. I'll advise you to read the Fortress of Muslim and to see the adhkar after the salah. وعن كعب as well, do we have that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he finished his salah, he used to do Subhanallah 33 times. Yeah? Alhamdulillah 33 times and 34 times to say Allahu Akbar after every salah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Hurairah, whoever did tasbih 33 times and tahmid 33 times and takbir 33 times, this is 99. And the end of that, you say La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu lahul mulku wa lahul hamdu wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. Allah will wipe all your sins, even if it was like the foam of the sea. Subhanallah. وعن معاذ بن جبل رضي الله عنه as well that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said يا معاذ إن لا تدعنا أن تقول دبر كل صلى الله من اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك oh Allah help me to your remembrance and to be thankful to you and to worship you in the best way. وعن أبي أمامة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم he said whoever read آية الكرسي after every salah nothing will prevent him entering Jannah except if he died. You have to read آية الكرسي. وعن عقبة بن عامر that as well أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم to read معوذات after every salah. وعن أم سلمة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يقول إذا صلى الصبح اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. So all these things are the أذكار after every salah, the authentic ones. There are many, and those are the most ones, the most common one that the Prophet used to do and used to encourage the people to do. Now we have a hadith that the Sahaba of the Prophet used to know that the salah was ended when they used to hear the takbir. Now some scholars said the takbir, as Ahlul Hadith in fact, for example, others, they say takbir literally to say Allahu Akbar after the salah directly, and then to do all of these things. And as well, the meaning of this, after they hear the takbir, meaning the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jalla, meaning sometimes as well, it is fine to talk normally or to have a normal voice in the, or normal volume, the volume of your voice when you are doing the dhikr. You have to say Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. And as well, I will add to you another hadith which is not mentioned here, that one Sahabi of the Prophet, one of the Sahaba of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that he saw in the dream what he should do. And an angel came to him or told him, if you say after every salah, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, 25 times. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, 25 times. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, and as well, it is good thing to do, as well, these are things that better for you to do it after the salah. To say the 33 times, Subhanallah, 33 times, Alhamdulillah, 34 or 33 times, Allahu Akbar, and to end with La ilaha wahdahu la sharika lahu al-mulku wa al-hamdu wa kulli shay'in qadir. Or to say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, 25 times. Those are the. And how to reconcile between that? It is from time to time to do different sunnah. Don't make your salah as habit. Whatever you know comes to your mind, you know the same surah you repeat, the same dhikr you do all the time. Try to change. In ruku', so to say Subhan Rabbi al-Azim sometimes. Sometimes to say Subhan Rabbi al-Azim wa bihamdih. Yeah? And to add to the Subhan Quddus Rabbi al-Malaik wa ruh. In sujood, Subhan Rabbi al-A'la. Sometimes Subhan Rabbi al-A'la wa bihamdih. So, and different one, different dua, different supplication try to use in the salah and after the salah.
The three calls. Do you read those as well?
Yes. So after every salah, it was said this. أقرأ بالمعوذات as well, meaning especially the معوذات, and as well especially after Fajr and Maghrib, to say the three قل after Fajr and Maghrib. Yeah, after Maghrib and Fajr. What are the things that better not to do in the Salah? Now here, this is important thing which we need to learn. Things which is makruh, disliked to be done in the Salah. العبث بالثوب أو بالبدن غير حاجة. Meaning, people to try playing with your clothes, with your body, with no any reasons. Yeah, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said إن الرجل يسوي التراب حيث يسجد قال إن كنت فاعلا فواحدة. That he said, one man said to the Prophet, sometimes when you go to sujood, you know, we need to make up the soil, and it, because sometimes the soil is not properly, you know, leveled, yeah? So that to make it in a level, so you could do sujood on. Then the Prophet said to him, if you are able to do that, then do once at least. Some people, what they do in the salah, yani especially if you have an yani occasion, mashallah, important occasion, yani you go to a place or a party or something, and then you... and sister with hijab, I keep making the hijab and forgetting things and putting things and sometimes maybe putting perfume and that, all these things. Yeah? You're invalidating your salah. Yeah? And I remember the first time I went to Umrah, I bought a new shumar like this, yeah? And when people who knows, if you don't buy good quality of these ones, yeah? It will annoy you in the salah. It will annoy you all the time. You need to adjust it all the time. And I was so happy that I'm wearing something, yeah, new, and it wasn't even good quality. So I was, subhanAllah, in the salah, adjusting it all the time. After I finished, Pakistani to Jazallah Khair, he said to me, he said, what's this salah? In Arabic, he said, in broken Arabic. Yes, I salah. So I was shy, I was ashamed from myself, yeah? So that's the same thing for anyone. If you are, have something in you or something like that, do not make it to prevent you from doing salah. It was said that one day that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah, his father gave to a came to Sayyid ibn Sayyid and to educate him. So one day Amr al-Adil, he came late for the Salah. He said to him, why are you late? He said to him, the woman who's combing my hair, she took more time in combing my hair. So that's why I was late. Then he ordered, so look at the teachers in the past. Then he commanded him to shave his hair. It's this thing which makes you deny the Salah? We don't want it totally. And he commanded him to shave the hair. He shaved his hair. So that's why things that makes you in the Salah, and you know, don't keep doing things. As well, subhanAllah, I'll tell you something. Yeah. A man said to me, he said, if I forget something or lost something, I will pray, I will find it in the Salah. Do you think this is good? This is bad. Because in the Salah, you keep thinking about it, the shaitan keep making it think more, and then it's, oh, it's there, it is in that place, it is there, it's that. Yeah? So instead of him focusing his Salah, he is focusing and finding his thing. And he said, always, whenever I lose something, I will pray. And he knows that. I said, the Salah is wasted, yeah, subhanAllah. Yeah? Al-Ikhtisar. وَهُوَ لِيَضَعَ الْمُصَلِّ يَدَعَ الْخَسَرْتِ. For example, yeah, when you go in the Salah to do like this, yeah? This is prohibited to do it. That the Prophet said, نَهَا نُصَلِّ رَجُلْ مُخْتَسَرْ. نَهَا, he prohibited to do like this. As if يعني, you are waking. Or some people, they said, even subhanAllah. Wallahi, I will tell you something. And we know what's the body language, yeah? Most of you know what's this, yeah, what's the body language. And most of you maybe applied to jobs, or you wanted to apply to a job. If you go to someone who you will be working with, and you enter, or you're waiting outside, enter through, you're doing like this, what does it mean? What does it mean? Yeah? Do you think they'll accept you? You will not do it. Because you think you're gonna get a job, you need money. Look at that, subhanAllah. And even how I see people, between the adhan and the qamah, they'll do like this. And then they will look into the clock here, and then they will look at the time, and then they will look there, subhanAllah. Wallah, this is, doing like this as if you are in a rush and you want things to happen quickly. Yeah, subhanAllah. By you can't understand that what you are doing, you are disrespectful to Allah Azza wa Jal. The Salah, you should be, subhanAllah, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, you are in Salah as long as you are waiting for Salah. Between the Adhan and the Iqamah, and you just came, you prayed 2 rak'ah, and you wait for the next Salah, Allah is rewarding you for every single second as if you are in Salah. As if you are in Salah. And people, they keep, and subhanAllah, and if the Imam was late for 1 second, subhanAllah, everyone look back, يعني, as if يعني, the Imam, he did something, يعني, أعوذ بالله, يعني, he did a crime, and he came late. But look, that's why I hate this masajid, many of the masajid, the clock, this one which has the timing, between Adhan and Iqamah. Yeah, you don't know. If you have a regular Imam, you wait until the Imam comes. The Sahaba used to wait. And one day the Prophet left him until nearly the middle of the night. He did this to them. Do not say, oh, what happened? We have work tomorrow. I have my cattle in the other side of the city I need to bring. No, no, they said this. They waited for the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And as well, the Imam has to be reasonable as well with the people. But the point is, don't be, when you are, as long as you're waiting for the Salah, remember that you're worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal. Yeah? As well, looking up, see people, especially, subhanAllah, sometimes, do you see Salat Taraweeh when they record it in Medina and Mecca? When they come, they will find someone in the, you will look at the camera. You see them? That's me, I'm praying. Or someone will do this, he will do the Salah. SubhanAllah, yeah. Taking selfie in Salah. SubhanAllah. Yeah, they do, yeah, I saw this. Oh, this is khushu'. They say this, I'm doing khushu'. And they might put some tears here. Yeah. I'm with tears as well. SubhanAllah, yeah. Wallah, we are in a time, Allah, we see all this nonsense, isn't it? Especially these things, Allah, I sometimes, when I see, subhanAllah, when you see Mecca or Medina, and you see Quran is recited, subhanAllah, something, our hearts is attached to Mecca and Medina. Our hearts, subhanAllah, attached to these great places. And then he wanted to see Salat al-Tarawih. And someone looked at the camera. What are you doing there? The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at the severe warning that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that people to stop this evil deed, to raise their gaze, to raise their sight, yeah, up. عند الدعاء في الصلاة, even دعاء in the salah, even تراويح. So, you like this, you see them in دعاء. يعني سبحان الله, why do you look at the heavens? You know, Allah is seeing you, أخوان. Allah is seeing you. You don't need to, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, one day he behind the Sahaba, they were shouting in دعاء. He said, oh, you are not calling someone who's deaf. Allah will hear you. Yeah. So he said, all their sight will be taken. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, their sight will be taken from them. So that's why humble yourself to Allah azza wa jalla. Raise your hand, okay, fine. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to raise his hand like that, fine. But keep you, why the eyes towards your place of sujood? To humble yourself to Allah azza wa jalla. وَقُومُ لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ. To stand before Allah with humility, with humbleness. Yeah. الْإِلْتِفَاتُ لِغَيْرِ حَاجَةٍ. To look behind or around you with no valid reason. Yeah? That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in hadith Aisha, he said, she asked him about, what about looking around? Then he said, it is the shaitan taking portion of your salah or portion of the reward of your salah away from you. Yeah? I will tell you who is more than the others. Yeah? More in doing this in the salah, men. Yeah? Especially when they are attending something, or they might engagement or his nikah day, and he keep doing this in the salah. Yeah? The men, they do more than the women. Yeah. But in the houses, if there is the women, they do something else. They do more. The men they do it, but women they do more. If you are inviting people to your house, yeah, and then they will keep looking around, yeah, if there is something wrong there. If there is something that's not proper there, this is in the salah. Yeah? In the salah. Well, in the salah, they will look around. Yeah? Yes, they wanted to host the people and they want to have, they don't want people to look at their house like they have a messy house or something like that. But sometimes you are praying to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Focus on your salah, then you will finish. After you finish, you will sort out, inshallah, all these things. And the same thing as with some brothers, and the same thing. Sometimes you see, brothers, when someone comes and says, what's this? As if there is something behind them. Just finish your salah, then inshallah, you could look behind. And this is the Prophet ﷺ, he said, as if the shaitan is deducting from the reward, from your reward. Another ilama, to look into things that could take away from the focusing on the salah. Like the Prophet ﷺ, he said, one day, he, in front of him, that they brought a khamis or something which is made of straws and it has some colors and other things. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi, he said, these flags, they took my sight away while I'm focusing. Even though he's focusing, alayhi salatu wasalam, that these things could take a bit of his focus. Yeah, he said, take them. Yeah, and then the Prophet he commanded to be removed. Yeah. As well as السدل وتغطية الفم عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه نهى عن السدل في الصلاة ولنغطي الرجل فاه. السدل meaning the Prophet ﷺ, he prohibited that the cloth, your men, generally, especially in the salah, to be always dragged to the floor. Yeah, this is not for women, it's for men. Yeah, إسبال الرجل ثوبه من غير أن ينضم جانبيه بين يديه. As well, if you have a long thobe, try to bring it up. If it's too long, for example, and you're praying in that thawb. And this doesn't mean, for the brothers, doesn't mean you need to fold it. Folding the clothes is not from the sunnah. It's against the sunnah. So try to grab it as much as you can up, and then pray with it, inshallah. Yeah? And as well, to cover your mouth. Especially in our country, I don't know here. But here, I think they have this hat which covers the mouth. The hat, huh? Ninja hat, that mask hat, whatever. Yeah, this is even if it's cold weather, it doesn't mean you keep covering your mouth. And even sister of niqab, you shouldn't cover your face in the salah. And covering the mouth is prohibited in the salah. Like in my country, in the winter when you go to the people, because we have cold weather there, what they do, you'll find most of the people in the masjid are like that. Seriously. The masjid. They pray like this. They pray like this. And that's a mistake as well. The Prophet said he prohibited that. As well, if you have a thawb, which is part of it, which means you are praying inside this garment. Yani meaning, you have a garment, it doesn't have sleeves or something, it just covers your body from outside, and then you are touching your body to your body like this inside it. As well, this is as well one of the prohibited things to do, so, which means the arms should be outside this garment. At-tatha'ub as well, we call yelling, we call it, yawning. Yawning in the salah, it is from the shaitan. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, let him to try to fight it as much as he can. If you have to, then cover your mouth to the best of your ability. One of the good etiquettes that the scholars of Islam used to say, to cover your mouth with the back of your left arm, the back of your left hand. You know what? Some scholars, this is by the etiquette, it's not sunnah, but the etiquette. You know what?
Meeting people.
No. Because your right hand, you always use it. So it's always dirty and always being used. Yeah? And you generally, when you use toilet, you use the inside of your hand. But this is generally is not used. Yeah? That's why many people, when they want to test the perfume, they will put it here. Yeah? On there, they will use the atar. They will put it to smell it. Because generally, it's not generally used. Yeah? So, to cover the one, it's etiquette, is not sunnah, by the way. To cover as much as you can, even if you cover it with your right hand or whatever, to cover your mouth in yawning. Yeah. Al-busaq wujihat al-qibla, to spit towards the qibla or on your right side. Spitting meaning, and if you need to spit or something, the Prophet ﷺ sometimes, because of the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, there's no carpet. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, if you have to spit, then spit underneath your foot or spit on your left side. Now, spitting as well, including as well when shaitan whispers to you in the salah, as well the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, not to spit, is to do like this, like that, yeah? On your left side in the salah. This doesn't mean spitting, and it doesn't mean to spit to the one beside you here, to keep spitting on the guy, yeah? So, to spit like a bit towards the left, and say, this is if the shaitan whispers to you in the salah, and keep taking you away from your salah, yeah? And as well, that's why, and do not spit as well towards the Qibla, don't spit on your right, and if you have to, then spit on your left side or underneath your foot, yeah? Or underneath your left foot, yeah? And as well, if it comes quickly, you couldn't stop it, then use your, whatever, if you have tissue or something, this is nowadays, use a tissue and try to take this spit away from you. As well in the salah, to put your fingers like this, yeah? To keep your fingers between each other like this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not just in the salah, even outside the salah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, that he came to pray, he made wudu at his home, and he came to pray, then let him not do this, to put his finger together. Even on the way, that's why they're sitting in the masjid, what people they do generally, they will sit waiting for the salah like this. This is not from the etiquette. It is prohibited to do it. Even in Jum'ah or anything or any time. Yani when you are waiting for the salah or you're going towards the salah, do not do it. So, and it is more severe in the salah. Yeah? Kashru al-sha'ri wa thawb. Yeah? An ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu. Kaffu al-sha'ri wa thawb. An ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أمرت أن أسجد على سبعة ولا أكف شعرا ولا ثوبا. He said I was commanded to prostrate on four arms, on four bones, and I was commanded not to bend any garment or my hair. What's the meaning of that? Meaning your hair, yeah. And this is for men, for example, especially men, or especially for men and women, both the same ruling. Meaning to fold it in a way that's to fold it, that is not, it's not good to do it in the salah. So better either if you cover it, and if you cover it, you don't need to fold it. That's one thing. And folding, it doesn't mean to make these plates or something. We call it plates or plates, whatever. platters. Don't make it like making platters. So it's okay. But what I'm saying, to fold it. That's one thing. And as well, folding the unfolding, for example, your garment, either your trouser or your, for example, your sleeves. This is prohibited to do it, or better not to do it. تقديم ركبتي على يديه في السجود. He said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, to start with your knees on sujood before your hands. And we talked about it before. بسطوا اليدين في السجود. As well as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, ولا يسطح أحدكم ذراعيه بساط الكلب. He said, don't place your full arm on the floor like the dog, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And as well, he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, الصلاة بحضرة الطعام وهو دافع الأخبثين. He said, and as well, do not لا صلاة بحضرة الطعام وهو يدافع الأخبثين. He said, the salah better not to pray if there is food, for example, especially for example Ramadan. What people do, they will put the food, say, let's go to pray. Yeah. SubhanAllah, all the time we keep thinking about the food and he keep trying to hold his saliva until finish the salah. What's this like? Eat something, eat a good portion or sufficient until you are kind of satisfied from the food, then go and pray. Yeah? There is no rush. Yeah? Go and pray. And as well, or especially if you want to use toilet, for example, if you want to use number one or two, and people, they will just keep moving around, just wanted to pray, and that's as well, it's prohibited to do that, and could invalidate your salah. Some scholars, they said the salah is invalid in that case. Some scholars, they said the salah is invalid. But actually, it is valid, but there's no focus. What kind of salah that you're not focusing? As well, to haste in the salah, and racing with imam. To race with your imam. Sometimes when I play with some brothers, I see him on the floor before me. What's this? And I would say, Allahu Akbar, this guy is there. Yeah? SubhanAllah. Or sometimes, I will try to rush before them because I don't want them to invalidate the salah. So I will stand up, and I'm rushing, he's more than me. Yeah, the more I try to rush, he will rush more than me. SubhanAllah. Yeah? Look at the severe warning of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, if you don't want amongst you fear that if he raises his hand before the imam to make his head like the head of a donkey, or to make his image like the image of a donkey. SubhanAllah, it means follow the imam. Before the imam to follow, not to be before him, follow him. So these are things that the person should do in the salah. Now, this is the last, inshallah ta'ala, thing. Before we finish, what are the things recommended to do it? Ma yubah, what are the things allowed to do it in the salah? You are allowed to walk for a need. If there is a need, you are allowed to walk in the salah. I'm saying with walking in the salah, few steps, not walk in a park. Few steps. Yani, you are behind you with the door, or beside you with the door. Someone knocked on your door, for example, your room. So you went, you opened the door, and you continue your salah. It is fine, your salah is valid. It's fine to do it. But if you live in a house and you're sitting on the upper floor and then someone was ringing in the middle down floor and then you go all the way down, all the way the stairs down and open the thing and go back to your place. What's this? Yani, that's not salah. Say anything else except salah. Walking in salah, it's allowed as long as there is a need and it is reasonable. And a few steps here, a few steps towards front, a few steps on the right, the left, behind, it's fine. But if it's too much, then in that case, you cannot do it in the salah. Now, I will give you an example. If you came to a masjid, you pray behind, and then you do the ruku, whatever, when the imam is doing the ruku. And then you keep walking until you catch the imam. It's fine. Yeah? And even though the scholar, they said to what extent, as long as you are in the masjid. If you are in the masjid and you prayed the two, you did the takbir al-ihram, you to ruku, and then you may walk until you get to the ruh. It's fine to do it. But it doesn't mean you do the takbir by your home. Especially in our countries, they have the speakers. So you could hear them and they say, Allahu Akbar. You say, you're on the street, Allahu Akbar. And you just go on and say, until you, that's not right. Until you enter the masjid, then you do it. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he said, if you come to the masjid, and then you do the ruh. Tayyib. Walking, as I said to you, that hadith Aisha radiallahu anha, look at this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray while the door is closed. Then he came and asked to come. Then he came, he famasha, and he walked, and then he opened the door, then he came back. And the door was towards the Qibla. But if it wasn't towards the Qibla, as well it's allowed to go right or left or behind. Yeah, as long as you keep facing the Qibla. Right. One of the things as well, to carry the child in the Salah, it is permissible as well. Carrying the child, the infant or baby in the Salah, it's allowed. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he brought Umama bin to Zainab. Yeah, Zainab, the daughter of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he brought her daughter, and he brought her to Salat al-Asr, and Wali Abil As, and she's the daughter of Abil As ibn Rabi'. Then when he used to carry her, alayhi salatu wasalam. When he used to go to sujood, he would put her beside him, then he would do sujood beside her, and then he would bring her up, and he was the imam, he was leading the salah. Can you imagine, imam will come with his baby to the masjid, and he will lead the salah while holding the baby in the masjid. This, subhanAllah, look at the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That his granddaughter, he brought her to the masjid, and he led the salah while carrying her. Yeah, in the salah. And this is as well to show for the sisters who have a baby that it doesn't mean, oh, I'm carrying the baby, I don't know how long I pray. No, I pray even while carrying your baby, no problem. You could do it. You carry and then you don't need, if you can't move the hand, then move the other hand. You could go ruku while holding the baby, like that as well. When you go to sujood, put the baby, for example, on the chair or on the floor, on a safe place, and do sujood beside the baby, and then when you sit in the middle, then you could carry the baby back. Or when you stand up, you could carry the baby as well. It is permissible to do that. Killing the scorpion or the snake in the salah as well is permissible. And if you attack by a snake or a scorpion around you, you don't need to run, you could kill them in the salah as well. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, he command even killing the scorpion or the snake even in the salah. الالتفات والإشارة المفهمة للحاجة as well to give the sign in the salah, yeah, or to look or to turn the face and to give a sign in the salah, then it is permissible in salah. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one day he couldn't stand عليه الصلاة والسلام, then we prayed behind him while he is sitting عليه الصلاة والسلام, then he looked at us and he looked back and he gave a sign to stand. Then فرآنا قياما, he saw us standing behind him, then he told us to sit down, then we sat behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was sitting, we didn't pray standing, and then he looked back to the Sahaba and told them not to stand, to sit down, to follow him alayhi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they followed him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. البساق في ثوبه أو إخراج من دينه, and as well to spit, for example, on something. That as well that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we said, hold on a second. Yeah, as well we said carrying the baby, as well if you have a tissue or something, that as well it's permissible. Al-ishara barad al-salam ala man sallam alayhi, as well to respond with the salam to the one who giving you salam in the salah. Yeah, so someone came to the masjid and said salam alaykum, you may respond like this. Yeah, but here. Again, you should be reasonable. If you are in a masjid and everyone knows you, and everyone comes salam alaykum, and keep doing this, then there is no salah. Yeah? So try to be reasonable again. If it's one incident, one off, two off, it's fine. Yeah? That's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, فَقُلْتُ لِبِلَالِ كَيْفَ رَأَتِ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَرُدُّ عَلَيْهِمْ. He said, how did you see that the Prophet used to respond to the Sahaba when they used to give him salam? He used to say, he used to do that, this, and raising his hand alayhi salatu wasalam. Yeah? Now, تسبيح الرجال وتسبيح النساء. If there is a mistake in the salah, the men should say subhanallah. If the imam made a mistake, to say subhanallah for the men. The women, what they should do? And I'm talking about, yeah? I'm saying a clap that makes the imam understanding that there is a mistake in the salah. And that's why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ مَا لَكُمْ حِينَ نَابَكُمْ شَيْءٍ فِي الصَّلَاةِ أَخَذْتُمْ فِي التَّصْفِيقِ. That the men and women used to do clapping. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, تَصْفِيق for women. And the mim, they should say Subhanallah. Yeah? And that's the, what the mim they should do. As well, Fathu ila al-Imam, yeah? When the person, for example, forgets something in the recitation of the Quran, that it is permissible for you, for the one who's behind the Imam, to rectify the Imam if there is anything. غمز رجل النائم as well. كنت أمد رجل في قبلة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصلي فإذا سجد غمزني فرفعتها فإذا قام مددتها. That when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم as well, when the person sleep, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was praying, and then because he had a small house عليه الصلاة والسلام, and Aisha was in front of him, so he used to give a sign for Aisha to remove her from her foot, and we go to the do sujood, and we come back, and then she will put back her foot again. And that's what it's permissible in the salah. As well, مقاتل في الأراضي المرور بين يدي المصلي. As well, to fight or to stop those ones who try to walk between you and your sutra. Yeah. As well, فأراد أن يستد بين يدي فليدع فليدفع في نحره. He said, mean, let him push him away. If someone comes try to walk between you and your sutra, push him away. Don't allow someone to walk between you and your sutra. Even if you push them away, because they are شياطين. سبحان الله. As the Prophet said, فإنما هو شيطان. Crying in the salah is permissible, as well in the salah, that the Prophet ﷺ, he one day he was praying in Badr, he was praying under a tree, and he was praying while he was crying, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What are the things that invalidate your salah? Yeah, the salah is invalid, your salah is void. If you pass wind, and the Prophet ﷺ used to stop his salah, if he hears a voice. And if you hear the sound of your, let's see, the sound of the fart, that means خلاص, that salah is invalid, you go and make wudu. Or if you smell a smell. Yeah. Other than that, some people they say, but I felt something, I didn't feel something. This feel something is from the shaitan. Yeah? From the shaitan. The shaitan wants you just to feel something, to keep you, you know, like, and I know someone, he will go and repeat his wudu like 5 times. He'll go and say, I felt something. So the shaitan, well, this is what the shaitan wants you. So that's why, avoid this. The only time that you stop, you hear a sound, you smell a smell, then go. Other than that, you just carry on your salah. تَرْكُ رُكْنَ الْأَرْكَانَ وَشَرْتُ مُشُرْكُونَ عَمْدًا أَوْ بِدُونَ عُذْرٍ. That you leave one of the pillars, one of the conditions, or one of the pillars, yeah, knowing of leaving them, or without a valid reason. That the Prophet ﷺ said to the man, go back to pray again for the one who made a mistake in the salah, because he didn't pray, because he was rushing in the salah. So he didn't settle standing, he didn't settle sitting, he didn't settle bowing, all these things. Now as well, to stand in the salah, you have to have a valid reason to sit down. If you don't have a valid reason, you cannot sit down in the obligation salah. But the voluntary salah, you could. But the obligation salah, you have to stand. Bowing, you have to bow at the Prophet ﷺ. If you couldn't do it, then you are exempted. Yeah? So that's why, if you don't have a valid reason, then leaving it will invalidate your salah. Any of the pillars of salah. Eating, drinking in salah, chewing chewing gum included, having juice, having water, all these things, it will invalidate your salah. Yeah? Now, في التطوع عند الجمهور لأنه أبطل الفرض as well they said between يعني anyone who invalidated the obligation prayer will invalidate the voluntary prayer. To talk with no valid reason, yeah, that at the time of Zayd ibn Arqam, he said, we used to talk at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam until Allah has said in the Quran, وَقُومُ لِلَّهَ قَانِتِينَ, stand before Allah with focusing on the salah, and we were commanded to be silent, not to talk in the salah. Laughing in the salah, we're not talking about the smile. And sometimes you might, and sometimes Shaitan brings you all the funny jokes in your life that come to you. Subhanallah, you said that. Yeah? So all these things couldn't, that as long as smiling, it doesn't invalidate your salah. When the sound comes, that's your salah is invalid. You need to repeat your salah. As well, things which could invalidate the salah, when an adult woman passed between you and your sutra, or if there is, for example, a black dog or a donkey passed between you and your sutra, then in that case, this could invalidate the salah, as the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith that should be like the height of the length of the saddle, which is around between 30 and 40 centimeters. This is the sutra, and anyone who passed by you to deduct from the salah. And if a woman passed between you and your, which means this is as well, a woman between you and your sutra, or something else, for example, like a black duke or a donkey that invalid the salah. If two men pass between you and your sutra, the whole of your salah, that reward will be invalid. So these are the full things which is related to the salah. Next time, inshallah ta'ala, we'll talk about the salah al-tatawwu, the salah which is voluntary salah, inshallah ta'ala, next time. Now, next week, as I told you, I might not be coming, inshallah. If I didn't go ahead, yani most likely I'm not coming. If I travel, that's the default. If something happens which made me not to travel, I will text Adam that I'll be here on Friday, then we'll carry on the class as normal. Yeah? But I will let you know when, if you didn't hear from me until Wednesday, it means until Tuesday. If you didn't hear from me until Tuesday, that means the next week is when there's no class. If you hear from me, that means there will be a class next week. Yeah? Clear with everyone? Any questions? Yes?
So the sitting of the sit on your heels, is that only between the two sujoods? Or is that?
Only between the two sujoods.
So you can't do the two sujoods?
No. Yes?
You know when you're praying in Jama'at,
yeah,
you don't read with the Imam on Fatiha, because it invalidates prayer.
Which, what you don't read? Which Salah?
During the Jama'at, you don't read
the Fatiha. Al-Jama'at, all Jama'at?
Yeah.
No, that's invalidated the prayer. So you should recite behind the Imam Fatiha. We discussed here. You should recite behind. There's difference of opinion that if you pray behind the Imam in the Maghrib or Isha or Fajr, where the Imam recites loudly, then some scholars, they said you do need to read Fatiha behind the Imam. But actually, what we discussed here, no, you have to read Fatiha even in the loud, you know, in the loud prayer, meaning in Maghrib, Isha and Fajr, you have to read even behind the Imam. Yeah, you have to read the Fatiha.
Out loud or in your heart?
Huh?
Out loud or in your heart?
Moving your lips, that's
yeah.
It. Yeah, you don't need to shout, and you don't need just only moving your lips, sufficient. And not without moving your lips, you have to move your lips in that. As Allah says, لَا تَحَرِكْ بِهِ لِسَانَ. So, moving the lips and the tongue with the recitation. So, you have to read the Fatiha. It's a pillar. What we discussed here, we said there's a pillar of the Salah, which could invalidate, if you didn't do it, it's invalidating your Salah. And we said there is a difference of opinion that about the, not the, about reading the Fatiha behind the Imam in the loud prayers, like for example, Maghrib and Isha and Fajr. Other than that, you have to all the time, but we said there's a different opinion on that. Wallahu ta'ala. Any other questions? Jama'ah or alone? Same. Any other questions? Taib, okay. Jazakumullah khair all. May Allah reward you all. And we'll see you, inshallah ta'ala, next time. Who is from the sisters? Who can be admin for the sisters?